In this episode, I'm going to talk about the relevant parameters for production of the filament used in material extrusion. So material extrusion, what we have here is we have this filament, which has ideally a constant diameter. The typical materials on the market are 1.75 and 2.85 millimeters in diameter, and they're fed into the extrusion head and then being printed. So inside of the print head, because of melting, the material is reshaped. But it's very important that we have a filament feedstock available to actually feed into our material. And it makes it durable, exchangeable. So the filament feedstock really gives us a lot of flexibility. And in order to produce the filament, we use an extruder. And the flow behavior of the material is super important, not only for the printing, but also for the filament production. And rheology is the science of deformation and flow. And in polymer analysis and processing, different effects happen on different time scales and need to be characterized by different rates of deformation. And I wanted to remind you, when we talked about polymer powder bed fusion, we were mostly focusing on rotational rheometers because we were interested in molecular motion and entanglements, because we don't have any shear deformation acting on the powder once it's melted, but we want the coalescence of the powder particles. So we need to look at the molecular motion. When we think of extrusion, regardless if it's the filament extrusion or the material extrusion 3D printing process, we extrude material through a nozzle, we push it under pressure, and we have higher shear rates. So for that, the capillary rheometer is really interesting. And that is more related to the actual production process, for example, extrusion. And I'll show you in the next episode, actually, not only for extrusion, but for the 3D printing process, what shear rates we actually have. And so you can use both technologies to obtain shear rate dependent viscosity, but the rotational rheometer is really limited when it comes to the higher shear rates. It's more about the molecular mobility. You can also look at viscoelastic properties. And when we want to study the effect of high shear rates, we have to go to the capillary. And here you see a curve that is composed of two different measurements on the same material. The blue is the shear viscosity at lower shear rates, measured in a rotational rheometer like our Kinexus. And the red dots are the measurement of the same material at higher shear rates in our capillary rheometers, the ROSAND series. And this area is actually interesting for material extrusion, both for the filament and then for the 3D printed part. So how does a viscosity flow curve look? We haven't talked much about that yet. But for all polymers, most samples that you can see, we have three regions, a shear rate independent region at low shear rates. So this is a straight line. We don't see an effect of the shear rate on the viscosity. So we call that zero shear region. And then eventually, based on the molecular structure, the shear thinning region begins, and that's where the viscosity becomes shear rate dependent, and it normally decreases. That's why we call it shear thinning. The material has less resistance to flow, flows more easily. And then that is because the molecular chains start to shear against each other, and once they are completely aligned and there's no entanglements anymore, then we reach the infinite shear region that's again shear rate independent because there's no disentanglement anymore. The chains are just stretched to the maximum extent. And that's the typical viscosity flow curve. Normally, we only measure up to this point because you need very high shear rates in your process to ever get close to this. For spinning, fiber blowing, that's an important region, but for material extrusion, we're really somewhere here. So we'll focus on that. How do you extrude filament? So this is an example setup of an extrusion line that is also installed at the Polymer Engineering Center at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And this is the setup as it was a couple of years ago, starting with a single screw extruder, where the material is fed into this hopper, and with the rotation of the screw, it's plasticized and it's conveyed to the die, where it's shaped into the circular melt that we're extruding. And we have a temperature profile going from lower temperatures, so the pellets don't stick to each other and don't get clogged up in this area, all the way to the die where we have the highest temperature. And for an ABS, a setting could be 205°C as the extrusion temperature. And then the die is much wider than the actual filament because it's drawn down by all the subsequent equipment, especially the belt puller. And in order to get from 11.7 to 2.85 millimeter filament, the puller speed was set around 11.3 meters per minute, but that's really a closed loop and that's set. So that was just the result we achieved, and you start with some settings, but that's really given by the laser micrometer. But let me go step by step. So we have the melt coming out of the die, and it goes into a pre-skinner that just really solidifies a very, very thin layer, a skin, on our filament that we can still reduce it in size without cracking that surface layer. And then we go into a water bath to cool the material. We want to really quench it down from 205 to room temperature as fast as possible, that we can still achieve a good and constant diameter. And we use vacuum because the vacuum helps us to achieve the circular shape that we want. And then in this setup, it goes through a laser micrometer, different directions of the laser that determine the diameter and the circularity. And based on that, the belt puller speed is in a closed loop control, in a closed loop controlled and sped up and reduced. So we get constant diameter. And then we have a winder to wind it on the spool. So we go from the pellets going in here to the filament being on the spool. And that's a schematic. And this is how it actually looked at the PEC in Madison. We have the extruder. So we're actually, this is the hopper, it's up, it's reversed. Here's where we feed in the material. Here it's where the material is melted. Here it's where it comes out. We see the pre-skinner. We see it here in more detail. So this is this area where the filament is coming in. Here is where you see the filament with a thin skin of material solidified. And then this is here. It goes into the water bath. And here the vacuum isn't already pulled. So it needs to be closed. And then eventually you have to build up the vacuum. So you lose a couple of meters at the beginning. And then we come out of the closed vacuum tank through the laser micrometer. And the belt puller. And now that we've seen how the filament setup works to produce the filament, we want to understand what the shear rates are that we have. And the shear rates in extrusion depend on the screw geometry, the temperature, and the pressure profile. That's just a couple of the most important factors. And they're typically between 300 and 1,000 reciprocal seconds. And this is well in the shear thinning region. So now let's look at how you actually measure the shear-dependent viscosity. We use a high-pressure capillary rheometer, as I already pointed out, and this is a schematic of how that looks. This is actually drawing, and this is a schematic where we have here a reservoir. That's where we put the pellets in. We have this capillary, that's the barrel that's heated and that melts the material. And we have a pressure transducer here that tells us the pressure in the reservoir, in the melt reservoir. And then we go against atmospheric pressure as we're extruding. So we go through this capillary and we extrude the material. So step by step, the piston, a piston is moved here. See it better here, or this is just the arrow. And it moves at a controlled speed and it's kept at a constant temperature through a capillary that can have different diameters. And the pressure is measured at the entrance to the die. And then when we have a constant or controlled piston speed, we have constant shear rate. Then the higher the viscosity, the higher is the resistance to flow. So we need more pressure to push it out, and the higher is the related shear stress. And then the viscosity is given as the shear stress over shear rate, tau over gamma dot. The controlled parameters are the piston speed, the distance that piston moves, and the temperature. And I put this schematic here because, as we have already talked about rotational rheometry in a previous episode, you see the same principle. With rotational rheometry, we talk about the shear between two plates and that that the upper plate is moved. This is the same principle. We shear layer by layer, and in the capillary rheometer, that's actually turned up, rotated, and this is where we have this shear profile. So where the speed at the wall is zero, so we have no slip, and in the center, it's maximum. And so we control these parameters and we measure the pressure, and then the relations that we're looking at is the relation of pressure to shear stress, that's given by this equation, and the displacement to shear rate given by this equation, and you'll see those again. The temperature needs to be constant because of the temperature dependence of the rheological behavior. And now, how does the measurement really work and what analysis are we doing? So we use different piston speeds, and that applies a different shear rate on the sample. That's dependent on the die diameter, so we can switch the capillaries out. And then once we reach an equilibrium pressure, it's recorded and the shear viscosity is calculated. So equilibrium pressure means, here you see the pressure of the piston, and as soon as it reaches an equilibrium, the pressure is increased. And with every pressure increase for that one capillary, we have different shear rates as a result. And then we can use the two relationships I just explained, and we can calculate the shear viscosity as a function of shear rate. And so for this pressure step, we get this shear viscosity and shear rate, then the second, the third, and so on and so on. And that's how we get a typical flow curve that I showed previously as a schematic. So this is how, for the ABS that I showed you, the extrusion parameters on the single screw extruder with 205 degrees C, how we use the same conditions in the capillary rheometer in our ROSAND to estimate the viscosity. So we did the pressure versus time measurement that I just showed, always equilibrium, then we continue to the next, and what we get is this shear viscosity versus shear rate we need a couple of corrections. I won't talk about that. You can check out other videos if you're interested in that. But the green dots really show us the shear viscosity over shear rate. And you see the shear rates here are already high enough, so we don't really see the zero shear viscosity plateau. And we're most interested in that shear thinning or shear rate dependence. And as I said, with a single screw extruder and extrusion, we have typically 300 to 1,000 reciprocal seconds. So within that window of shear rates, you can already see what a change in viscosity we can have. And then I want to show you why we did the measurement at 205, because that's the extrusion speed. But obviously, if we would increase the temperature, and I'm showing this here for, we have the 205, I'm showing it for 220 and 230. As the temperature increases, the viscosity decreases. And for the filament extrusion, that could be a problem because the viscosity shouldn't be too low that we can't get that filament extruded and stabilized into a filament. We might get dyed rule and we might not ever be able to feed it into our pre-skinner. So we need to understand the viscosity of the material and its temperature dependence, for example, to determine what's the best extrusion temperature. And you can do that by trial and error and just play with your extruder and waste a lot of material, or you can perform an offline measurement, really characterize the viscosity of your material, understand its temperature dependence and other factors. Melt strengths would also be a factor that you can study with a capillary rheometer that can tell you a lot about the filament extrusion. This filament extrusion. And you can determine the ideal process parameters ahead of time, and then you might only need minor adjustments. So again, this is super important because for material extrusion, we first need a filament that we can actually feed into our material. So this was more talking about the production of the feedstock for material extrusion.